Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Spring 2021 Student Moving Image Showcase. My name is Jason Evans Groth. I am the Digital Media Librarian here at NC State University Libraries, and this is one of my favorite programs of all time, all the time. We do this every semester and have since I started working at NC State in 2013 and before then. We have so much good content from so many great people and students and even some students from other universities tonight. So we're excited to have them. And rather than clogging up this feed with me talking, we're just going to jump right into it. And if there is an echo, we'll fix that on the next segment. Let's start with video.
Hi folks, I'm Jim Alchidiak from the Department of Communication. I teach a course called Digital Video Production. It's a course that covers visual language, lighting, lenses, sound, a variety of technical concerns, as well as storytelling. We are delighted to be part of this celebration by NCSU Libraries of student filmmaking. It's a really nice opportunity for students to showcase their work. And of course, it's increasingly rare for students to have an opportunity to see their work play in front of a live audience like yours. So we really value your interaction with our students and hope that you'll enjoy the production values you see on display in the work that's to come. Students, take it away.
Hi. My name is Gianna Brown, and my project is called Lonely. So I was tasked with developing a story that didn't have any captured dialogue. And this is during the pandemic, so one of the biggest challenges that I had was the fact that I only had myself, my camera, and my ring light. But ultimately, I did enjoy what I did, and I really liked how I started off the video in black and white and it transitioned into color, because that really fit along with the whole theme of, you know, doesn't have to be lonely being alone, even though we are in a pandemic, but it's about finding the joy and finding little pleasures that, you know, can get you through your day, even if you're alone. So thank you for watching my video.
You wait by a phone. I know you wish you had some. everyone, my name is Emily Elliott, and this is me and my partner, Addie Holm, short film, New Shoes. We made this short film for our digital video production class with Professor Alchidiak. Shout out to Professor Alchidiak. And the concept was just to take our own short film from pre-production to post-production and just do the whole things ourselves. And we just had a blast. We just wanted to make something that was fun to watch and fun to make. And I think it was fun for us to make, so I hope it's fun to watch. And it was a little tricky sometimes with some mild stunts, but we just had a great time. And thanks to Addie and Professor Alchidiak and the star of our film and my good friend, Jordan Nash, it was just an awesome experience. So I hope you guys enjoy it. I know I sure did.
Oh my God, I'm so sorry. Are you okay?
My name is Richard Bentigue. My movie is called Dream. It's about this failed tennis player who sort of having an existential crisis, and he's having to talk to this psychologist. But in the premise of the movie, the audience doesn't really know what is reality. So I think that's kind of a fun way to play around with that dream idea. The biggest challenge we came across is the COVID-19 factor and how we would go about it safely. Luckily, Matt and I, the co-creator of this movie, managed to create a script to where we would only have two characters in the film. And we managed to play as those characters to minimize the amount of personnel in our set. I want to thank Chris Lewis for doing all the drone shots. The drone shots definitely add a lot of dramatic factor into the movie. It gave it a lot that polished look and that professional look that we're all trying to achieve during filming of that movie. And lastly, I want to thank my co-creator, Matthew. This movie was made based from our ideas melding together. So I think that was kind of interesting where he wrote his own script and I wrote my own script, and we ended up combining it together to make one cohesive film. So I think that definitely worked out. And that's about it. I hope you guys enjoyed the movie. Bye-bye. Circles here.
Yeah, I could say the same. It seems like every time we come back here, my dreams are just the same revolving circle.
You have not progressed at all. Have you been taking the medications we prescribed to you?
Only when I have to.
I understand that you're still having these flying dreams.
Yeah, lately, every time I'm dreaming, I see myself flying, and I see myself trying to save people, and I'm wondering if that's a sign of something else. I've been coming to you, doctor, for a while, and we know how my tennis career has pretty much gone into shambles at this point. So in this dream, which seemed much like reality, I was, you know, just taking a nice jog in the park, and I saw a beam of light into the woods. It seems like it made me superhuman and gave me all these superpowers, and then I started flying and, you know, trying to, I guess, be a superhero for the day. And
very publishable.
Yeah, I don't understand if it's something to do with my tennis career failing me and why I'm having these dreams, but it seems like I just cannot sleep at nighttime until I take all this medicine, and then every time I do, it becomes a superhero dream.
Dream of hurting someone?
Well, most of the time I'm dreaming of saving people. I don't know what my duty in life is going to be, but yeah, I was once famous and apparently I'm not good anymore.
Well, Mr. Baldwin, I think I would prescribe you to drink plenty of water,
change your socks, and don't obsess on tennis too much.
I'll try my best.
Let me take you on a little trip, my supersonic ship's at your disposal if you feel so inclined. Travel faster than light, so do up your overcoat tight, and we'll go anywhere you want to decide.
Welcome back, everyone. So we just saw the first of four segments for tonight's show. That was the video production segment. And we have several of the creators with us. We have Gianna, we have Emily, and we have Richard. So let's start. First of all, I need to apologize. This is fun. This is live television. I need to apologize to Emily. Well, so we'll start with Emily because I broadcast her video in the wrong aspect ratio. So in the future, those of you who are watching live, come back and watch it again on replay to see it in the correct aspect ratio. So we'll just move forward. Going to cut this out of the replay later. Emily, let's start with you. Please reintroduce yourself and tell us what you made.
Well, hi, everybody. I'm Emily Elliott, and me and my partner, Addie Holmes, who couldn't be here today, we made our short film, New Shoes, for Professor LTDX class.
And Gianna?
Hi, I'm Gianna Brown. So yeah, I worked alone on this project, but I love doing it, and it was also a part of Miss RHODX class. And so, yeah, I made Lonely.
And Richard?
Hey, everyone. I'm Richard. Me and my partner, Matthew Baldwin, created the movie Dream. So
you got some really good response from probably colleagues, classmates, and just watchers in the chat. Let's work backwards. We'll start with Richard. I want to be sure you didn't shoot that drone shot on NC State campus.
It is not. So,
and you mentioned that it was ad-libbed. Can you talk a little bit about that? The movie we just watched?
Yeah, so we have like a rough kind of script for that. And we have a storyboard all lined up, but we didn't have like a set dialogue for each characters. But all we did was sat in a room for about 20, 30 minutes, and we just talked about different types of scenarios and different type of, like, if I was a psychiatrist, like what kind of questions I would be asking him, and if he was a patient, what kind of questions he'd be asking me. So that kind of back and forth. So we just sat there for like 30 minutes and just kind of talking and joking around. So a lot of it came out naturally. So, it really kind of accentuated the acting, because none of us are actors. So the most natural way to do it is just literally do it without any, you know, pre-written dialogues.
Right. Yeah. Something that kept coming up too in the chat while we were watching, and Emily, this we'll throw this one to you first, but if any of you have any responses, by all means do it. But Emily, angles and focus were mentioned a few times in yours. I actually have a question about that. A, I'm sure that was intentional, but you can speak to that. But B, is producing a movie during a pandemic, does that make you think more about the details when it comes to focus and angles? It's just something I thought of when we were watching it too.
Absolutely. I, unfortunately, am not the master behind the focus pulling and the angles of that. That was mostly Addie's work because he's just the master at that. But we really did have to plan out our shots very carefully because you don't really want to get too close to anybody nowadays, which is unfortunate when you're trying to make a movie. So shout out to Addie again for doing that, because he's just the master at that. And it was difficult, but I think we pulled it off. So
that was great. And Gianna, so to kind of move from that, your movie is about being alone. So, but you shot it all on your own. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. I had my Canon EOS R, my tripod, and my ring light, and I was just maneuvering around the house trying to figure out what shots I could get and how to frame them.
So, I want to look at the chat real quick just to remind you all what people are saying. We've got people talking about how great the special effects are. Gianna, when yours was up, people were talking, like John, our colleague who's going to be talking later, was talking about the really fun editing stuff going on. Did you find some freedom in working alone to make choices like that?
It's funny you say freedom because I was so stressed. I had never used the program before. So I was just trying to figure out any way to make what I shot interesting because I realized it's all in one location mainly. And so how do you make that creative? How do you find something that audiences are gonna still watch and not just turn away from because you're sitting in the same chair? So I had the program before and I had never used it. So this really gave me an opportunity to say, wow, like, doing the split screen. I didn't know how simple that really was. And I thought that was a cool addition. I really liked doing that because I thought it brought an extra element because it timed with the music. So I really liked just being able to try it out on my own. So yeah, it did bring some freedom as well, as you were saying, because I was able to do all that work and learn from the experience.
And Emily, what did you feel was your, you were talking about your partner having the those like shot, the shot expertise and stuff. What did you feel was something that you really brought to your excellent movie?
Well, Addy was kind enough to let me edit, and I learned how to do really sort of professional grade color correction for the first time while shooting the film. So it was really exciting because we storyboarded together, and he brought just a ton of knowledge about camera angles and staging and that stuff. And then I just got to sit down and edit it and show him as we went along. And it was really just a great experience. And I think we made a pretty good team, so.
Yeah, it was great. And finally, Richard, we've got lots of nice comments about sound effects and special effects. What do you think that you learned overall from this particular project?
I learned that along the way, you gotta save all your video files while you edit. So that was my first time using Adobe After Effects, and a lot of it I had to start over because my laptop is not powerful enough to do that kind of heavy duty lifting when it comes to special effects. And I think, from where my mind and my vision is going, I feel like it's something totally different. And then I try to put it on Adobe After Effects and it's totally, just not up to par to my vision. But I'm glad that I did it because it's, just the first step towards learning and creating more. So I'm glad I did that. But definitely save your files when you work on it.
Glad you got that plug in early as a librarian. I think I'm saying that to people every day. So, well, excellent work to all of our video production folks. Thank you so much for being in the Q&A. We're going to move into a brand new segment for the Moving Image Showcase. I'm really excited about this. This is these videos that we're about to watch come from a class taught by Dr. Adrian Smith, who is here with us tonight. I'm going to let Adrian introduce it. Go ahead, Adrian. Adrian, are you muted, Adrian?
There we go. I think. Hi. I'm good. Hi, sorry. Hi, Jason. Thanks for having us in the class or in this show. Yeah, I teach a course called Creative Media Production for Scientists, and it's open to all STEM grad students across the university. And we get students from physicists to chemists to people who work on snails and lizards. And it's all about unlocking their interest in presenting their science in mostly video medium. So they go through the entire process of making a piece of media, talking about their science. And we talk about the art of science communication and then some practical hands-on stuff. So I think we have two selections from that class tonight.
We certainly do. And let's get into them. And then we'll see you back in Q&A in a minute. So very excited to introduce this new segment. Let's enjoy it.
Hello. My name is Caitlin Knowles, and you're about to watch a video called The Science of Sourdough, which I made for a class taught by Dr. Adrian Smith on media production for scientists. This assignment was pretty interesting because there was no strict guideline on what you had to talk about. So I was pretty fascinated by sourdough at the moment, and still am, And so I decided to talk about that for the video. The biggest challenge probably with the assignment was just narrowing it down. Sourdough may already seem like a pretty small subject, but once you look into the literature, there are lots and lots of papers and lots of different directions that I could have taken the video. One thing to maybe watch out for in the video is that Adrian helped me with a time lapse of a sourdough starter. I went over to his lab where he had his lights and his camera, and I fed the starter and let it sit there for a day and came back and played it back, and it was pretty cool. So yeah, I hope you enjoy and I hope you learn something about bread.
For the past couple of months, I've been developing a bit of an obsession with sourdough bread. There's something about the magic of turning flour, salt, and water into a delicious loaf of bread that has me, and now a lot of my friends, completely hooked. The big intrigue of sourdough, though, is, of course, the starter. I feed mine religiously every morning, but I really have no idea what it is. I put blind faith in it every time I want to bake a loaf of bread that it'll turn out, but I really want to know what's actually happening in a sourdough starter. I'm a PhD student, and I'm going to look into this the same way I would with my own research, with, of course, a literature review. And wow, for someone coming from a material science background, sourdough science is way over my head. From my understanding, the sourdough starter can be broken into two main players, the yeast and the bacteria. The bacteria are of the Lactobacillus genus, where a genus is just a group of a bunch of different species. These bacteria are called lactic acid bacteria, which scientists nickname lab. A common species of the more than 50 species that scientists have found present in different starters from all over the world is Lactobacillus sanfranciscensis. Try to say that 5 times fast. These bacteria feed on sugar and produce lactic acid, acetic acid, a bit of CO2, and sometimes ethanol. This acidic environment is what's responsible for the slight tartness of sourdough and is also what keeps bad bacteria from spoiling the dough while it's fermenting. It's also important for improving the bioavailability of important minerals like calcium, magnesium, and iron by decreasing the phytate content of the bread. This is important because phytic acid, in addition to being a pretty complicated looking compound, is highly charged, meaning it's very reactive. It's so reactive that it'll actually attach to the minerals in the bread instead of letting them become absorbed by the body. So it's essentially stealing our food. But thankfully, there's enough bacteria to take care of that. In fact, there are a lot of organisms in a sourdough starter. In just 1 gram, there are 1 to 3 billion colony-forming units, or CFU, of bacteria, and 1 to 50 million of the other very important player, yeast. Wild yeast, which is naturally present all around us, in the air and on our hands, thrives in the acidic environment that the lactic acid bacteria produce. The yeast are of the Saccharomyces and Candida genuses, with more than 25 different species. During fermentation, these single-celled fungi break down the starch in the flour into sugar, giving off carbon dioxide and ethanol. Now that we have that out of the way, it's time to bake a loaf of bread. The first part of sourdough baking is making sure you have a good starter. You want to feed your starter regularly, once a day if you leave it on the counter, and once a week in the fridge. Feeding the starter is easy. Just add equal parts by weight, water, and flour, mix, and let sit for a couple of hours to let the yeast and bacteria eat the meal you just gave them. After you have a healthy starter, it's time to bake some bread. Here's how I make mine. I take 400 grams of flour and mix it with 6 grams of salt. Then I add 160 grams of my sourdough starter and 230 grams of water. I mix that until combined and then roll it out on the counter and knead for around 10 minutes. Then I plop it back into the bowl and mix everything in. Cover it and let it rise for 3 to 4 hours. After that first proof, I pour it out on the counter again, form it into a loaf shape, put it into a well-floured proofing basket, and then into the fridge overnight. When I take it out the next morning, I roll the loaf out of its basket, score it, put it in a preheated Dutch oven at 475 degrees Fahrenheit for 40 minutes, taking off the lid for the final 20 minutes. I then let it sit for as long as I can manage before digging in. I think it's safe to say I've become a little obsessed with baking sourdough over the past couple of months. Just baking it is fun, but learning about the science behind it is kind of addictive. It's genuinely fascinating to realize that something as simple as baking a loaf of bread involves complex processes that scientists have dedicated their lives to studying. So, if you're interested in learning more about the basic science of everyday things, maybe stick around. I'll be making these episodes as frequently as I can. I'm working on the next one now, and I think it's gonna be a good one. Any guesses?
Hi, my name is Tori Vayer, and the title of my film is Why America Needs Hunting Now. I originally made this film as the final project for Dr. Adrian Smith's Video Communication for Science majors class, and I chose this particular topic because, one, it's an extension of my master's research, but at the time, it also felt really relevant and timely because I made this right at the beginning of the COVID-19 lockdown restrictions, and there was a lot of stress surrounding food shortages and supply chain disruptions. So talking about hunting as a source of local ethical meat products without having to go to the grocery store felt particularly poignant in the spring of 2020. But also, that was definitely the biggest challenge of making this film, was the COVID-19 lockdown restrictions completely changed the story I wanted to tell and the characters I was able to introduce. But at the same time, it was also a really rewarding experience, and I'm so proud of the product I was able to create. And I really, really hope you all enjoy it. Before you watch, I do want to give a big thanks to everyone who helped make this project possible. So obviously Dr. Adrian Smith, but also my advisor, Dr. Lincoln Larson, the Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies, the United States Fish and Wildlife Service, and Backcountry Hunters and Anglers, plus so many more, but I can't thank you all in this short little intro. So you know who you are. Thank you all for being a part of this project and supporting me through all of this. I truly, really do hope you all enjoy watching this film. Thanks. What if I told you killing one animal could help save thousands? Look, I'm not a hunter, and honestly, I don't really want to become one. But I am a wildlife biologist, and as a wildlife biologist, I've come to understand how hunting helps conservation. Here's how. Hunting often gets a bad rap in the media, so it's no surprise that many of us are skeptical about supporting hunting, much less going hunting ourselves. My name is Tori, and I'm a grad student at NC State studying this very topic. As I film this video, I'm on day like 27 of social distancing due to the COVID-19 outbreak, and I realized how much I miss my friends and family. Humans are social creatures, and we thrive on interactions with each other, which got me to thinking. Many people misunderstand hunters and hunting, but maybe if we got to know hunters, we could better understand how much they have in common with other conservationists. Like my old pal Abe Lincoln once said, "I don't like that man. I must get to know him better." So, what do we know? Well, we know hunting's important for at least three really big reasons. Let's break those down. One, hunting provides a unique connection to the natural world. Most hunters are law-abiding, nature-loving conservationists like you and me, and many of them use hunting as a means to get local and ethically sourced meat. In fact, many of our nation's wildlife-based nonprofits are made up of hunters and anglers. Two, hunting is a cost-efficient and effective wildlife management tool. With the reduction of apex predators like wolves and mountain lions, deer populations are able to grow way too large, creeping into our urban and suburban environments where they spread diseases and cause car accidents. Hunting actually helps keep deer populations at levels that are safer for both humans and deer. And three, hunting provides almost 70% of our nation's revenue for natural resource management agencies through a tax on guns, ammo, and license sales. But due to the decline in number of hunters, our DNRs are in trouble, and they need our help keeping public lands open and accessible. As you can see, hunting is a really important part of sustaining conservation. But maybe you're like me and you don't want to become a hunter. So what can we do to help? I'm glad you asked. Introducing DCAP. Donate, communicate, advocate, participate. D, donate. Consider buying a hunting license even if you don't plan on hunting, buying a duck stamp, or donating directly to your local management agency. C, communicate. Share your public land stories with other public land users far and wide. Hunters and non-hunters have way more in common than we think, and swapping campfire stories is a great way to find that out. A. Advocate. Write to your congressperson or senator expressing your views on conservation policy, and consider getting more involved in local politics. And finally, P. Participate. And sure, this could mean actually going on a hunt, but this could also mean things like learning to cook game meat from a hunter, communicating with hunters in online forums to learn more, or participating in a hunting workshop. Recruiting new hunters and hunting advocates has become a top priority for DNRs across the country, so much so that many of them are offering hunting workshops that focus on recruitment, retention, and reactivation, or what we call R3. As a part of my thesis project, we designed and implemented one of these workshops specifically for college students who are first-time hunters. So, don't just take my word about all this. Let's take theirs.
You know, I would love to be able to take everybody that wanted to go hunting for the first time,
What's your favorite part about hunting?
I think just the solitude behind it that you get, but you also get a sense of camaraderie with people that's very ancestral, and it just really helps tie you to like the natural world in a very spiritual way. Of course, I like eating game.
As a mentor, what do you think the biggest barriers are that you help new hunters overcome?
Access and opportunity. So access would be to a place to actually go hunting. I think a lot of people are just very intimidated when they're beginning hunting on where to go. You know, the opportunity to have somebody teach you really when the time is coming where you plan on taking game. I think that's something critical to really get you started.
Taylor, you were a participant in our workshop, so you've never been hunting before, and I want to know a little bit about, like, why did you choose to do our workshop in the first place?
Yeah, so I've always been kind of interested in aspects of hunting. I've always been a little bit skeptical just because of the negative stereotypes, especially like being like a wildlife student. People are like, how can you be a wildlife student and then go out there and like kill deer or whatever, you know?
Did anything surprise you that you learned at the workshop?
I think I was also surprised how much like hunters are like passionate about the conservation and like the natural world side of things more than a lot of people assume or expect from hunters.
It's critical that people understand it is more than just going out and pulling the trigger, right?
I mean, obviously there are the aspects of they want the game meat. It's way more than that.
You get to see animals truly be animals, right?
Yeah, I mean, I wish I would have had that workshop whenever I'd begun hunting for the first time. I mean,
and like Andrew, as a mentor, like, what do you think about somebody like Taylor who is like, yeah, I'm definitely interested in going hunting, but is maybe not ready to start on their own?
We'd love to take you hunting for the first time. While I can't necessarily do that for everybody, I think it's really important to get involved in organizations where you can get that kind of support.
The biggest question of all, Taylor, are you ready to go hunting right now?
If I had somebody to go with, yes.
Let's recap real quick. Hunting provides a unique connection to nature. It helps balance ecosystems as a wildlife management tool. And it provides the majority of revenue for our natural resource management agencies to keep public lands open and accessible for all recreation activities. The COVID-19 pandemic has reminded us that we're all in this together. Whether it be beating a novel coronavirus or conserving natural resources and saving ecosystems. It is our interactions with each other and connections with other humans that drive what we do the most. So remember, donate, communicate, advocate, and participate from the safety of your home. Thanks, and I'll see y'all next time. I'd like to say thanks to NC State Department of Parks, Rec, and Tourism Management, my advisor, the students, staff, and faculty that helped make this video possible, along with the North Carolina Wildlife Resource Commission and North Carolina Backcountry Hunters and Anglers. Without y'all, the workshops wouldn't have happened and this video wouldn't be possible, so thank you for all your continued support. This research and these projects means the world to me. So thank you all for being a part of this, and stay safe. Come on.
Very excited to add this segment to the showcase. Dr. Smith is with us. Dr. Smith, can you give us reactions to the two movies that we just watched?
I love those two movies. Those students just knocked it out of the park. It's so fantastic to see them take on the challenge, like in the middle of, this was last spring. So like COVID happened in March, right? As they were getting into starting to work on their things. So a lot of students just switched like what they were gonna do their video on, switched what they had in mind for visuals. And they just nailed it regardless of the immediate change in situation. So both of these films I really love.
So I feel privileged that Dr. Smith has invited me into class to talk about libraries, resources, and you know, when things are open as they have been in the past, we get to work together a lot. I was flabbergasted by, given the circumstances or not, like the quality of these was so high, you know. Like for Caitlin's video, for example, as a person who is intrinsically related to baking, like it hit all the points that I think you try to make in that class, which is how do we make this stuff understandable to a wider audience, but also make it fun to watch? Like I find that video to be extremely fun to watch for many reasons. The production values, the script is easy to read. Is that part of what you're aiming for in class?
Yeah, it's like part of what I want to do is like give people permission to like think about science in a different way than what they're trained to do and how they're trained to talk about science. I mean, these are people who, you know, have undergrad degrees and then are in the midst of grad school, so they're like neck deep in like, you know, boring 40-minute, you know, seminars about whatever topics. And I try to like get everybody to flip that on their heads, you know, write with words, but also like write with visuals. Like this is a visual language that you're trying to express whatever it is, and kind of think about narrative in a way that you know, most science papers aren't written. So just kind of give people permission is to be creative and to think about presenting stuff in however they want is kind of my main goal.
Well, it's extremely effective. And Tori is here. Tori, excellent work. Tori's video was the last that we just watched. Tori, can you just give us a reflection? You saw some stuff going on in the chat. Like I think people were interested, not just in the fish, but also in the, I was commenting on how well you presented to the camera. It felt like it could work at a conference or at a showcase like this. How did you feel about making all those things work together?
Yeah, absolutely. Good questions. So first, the salmon has a functional purpose too. So like we've all been saying, this was me filming completely by myself on my back porch right as the COVID lockdown just started. And I don't have an auto-focusing camera. So I needed to put something in the chair to focus the camera. And then I would switch the fish to the other chair and then go sit down and try to film myself. So there was a purpose to it. And then I thought it would just be kind of fun to leave Sammy the Salmon in the frame as I filmed the rest of it. But in terms of speaking naturally to the camera, like a couple other students have said so far, I wrote a rough outline of the things I wanted to cover and what order I wanted to cover them in. And then I just practiced it 100 times. And this was probably the 7th or 8th take where I finally just could do it all from memory without having to look down at a sheet every 5 seconds. So, yeah.
Yeah, the acting, presenting, acting, it's so natural. And I think given what I've seen you present in the class, Dr. Smith, that is a hallmark of a really good science video that's meant for a wider audience. And so great work on that, Tori. And Tori, I have one more question for you, and then we're gonna move on to a completely different thing. But how did your, I'm not gonna say, I don't know what your advisors or other colleagues are like, but I assume you're in a traditional domain. How did they react to you? Like how positively did they react to you presenting this information this way?
bold of you to think it was all positive, Jason. No, it was by and large very positive. I think this was kind of like Adrian was saying, it's a different way to think about science. And that's really why I wanted to take this course to begin with, was as scientists, we don't often get to show our creative side and talk about just the pieces of our research that interest us. So my advisor was really happy with this. A lot of my colleagues were saying we need more of this, because this is something that's very easy to share on wide platforms and share with a wide variety of audiences. And it could cover a lot of ground talking about our research and really making sure our research access is able to be accessed by more people and different types of people at different levels of their education journey. So I think it was really positive in being able to communicate our research to audiences we didn't think we could reach earlier.
That's great. I'm so glad, again, glad we added this segment. And thank you, Dr. Smith. Thank you so much, Tori, for being here. Speaking of access, we're about to move into another kind of newer segment for the showcase. And I'm just going to let our advisor for this introduce it themselves. So enjoy our next segment, which I like to call Sonic Videos.
Hi, my name is Tori Ralston, and I teach for Art Studies, part of CHASS. I'm so excited to be here to explain the project the students made for this showcase. It's for a class called Interdisciplinary Arts Seminar, and the particular assignment is to create a 2-minute experimental sonic video. All of the imagery and sound components are created originally by the students and pulled together in an intermedial approach, which really, in our case, means that all the components are integral. And the other part of the assignment that makes it sort of unique and interesting for the students, I think, is that the sonic component is non-melodic and the visual is non-narrative. Anyway, I hope you enjoy these films. I'm so proud of the students, and it's wonderful to be here. Thanks.
Hello, my name is Grace, and the title of my video is Autumn Abstractions. The assignment was to create a non-narrative short film with audio that we had manipulated and edited. I mostly, for this film, just followed the process of where it took me and built off a bass sound and sort of just let it lead me into the climaxes and anticlimaxes. A challenge I faced with this was creating visuals to match the sound's intensity and emotion. I like that the inclusion of books in this film. I really love to read, as you can see, and I thought that was fun. Thank you for watching. I hope you have a great day. Thank you.
my name is John Copes, and my video is called Bravery, Power, and the Beauty in Resistance. For this project, we were tasked with creating an experimental video to go along with an experimental audio piece we'd made earlier in the semester using the principles of Fluxus. And I decided that I wanted to use footage from an experimental documentary that I was working on separately at the time, and to reframe it using those Fluxus principles to create an entirely new piece. And one of the challenges with that was taking something that was experimental, but still narrative in nature, and shifting it and thinking outside of the box to become something that was less of a narrative story and more of a sequence of images in harmony with the audio. So something to look out for when you're watching is the concept of rhythm and how the rhythm of the video and the rhythm of the audio work together, but also live separately as their own unique pieces. Thanks so much for watching, and I hope you enjoy.
We're back. What an amazing segment. We have at least one of our creators with us. John Copes is here. John, will you tell us about what we just saw from you?
Yeah, so my piece was obviously about some sort of like justice and protest like imagery that we'd been experiencing all through 2020 and kind of reflecting on that. And I was in production at the time for an experimental documentary about that sort of activity going on. And so I decided to reframe that and make it something even more experimental and something where I could really play with the audio and like making that track and then just like telling a story, but like in a different way. So that's kind of where it came from.
So there was a good question in the chat. Like one of the things I found most powerful about your piece is the layering of imagery when that statue is being dragged through the streets and the cops in riot gear are burning things. Those are two powerful images on top of one another. But the question in chat was about audio layering. And I know that the foundation of this assignment was audio. Can you talk about the amount of audio layering that was going on and how you decided what to use?
Yeah, it was a fair amount of layering. I started with a really basic drum and like snare track that you're hearing, that sort of steady beat throughout. And then I built on top of that. So I added the radio chatter and then some of the sounds from the images that you were seeing, but staggered from those images. And then I had that sort of like that vocal audio is actually a song that I took and I slowed and then flipped the audio so it played in reverse. And then I dragged it out and added effects on top of that to give even more like tone and mood to the piece. So it's like a few layers of like the videos and then also stuff that I made and put them together.
So return patrons will remember you from a beautiful film that we showed, I guess maybe last spring. I can't remember anymore.
Yeah.
And this is sort of the opposite. I mean, not that this isn't beautiful, but like that the film that we saw last spring was full of vibrant, bright colors and lots of static shots. What did you, and I know you make media otherwise, what did you find the most rewarding about this particular assignment in class?
I think the assignment I really enjoyed because it allowed us a lot of freedom. And like in the other ones that we saw in the showcase, like everyone had a different point of view. So that was really rewarding to see everyone's point of view. And for me, just making this piece, it was really nice to have like a reflective moment and to like go back and like after witnessing a bunch of really intense things and like a lot of the emotion like that comes with that, it was really nice to be reflective and to make something that expressed like the feelings of like witnessing those things or being there and sharing them and, you know, recording that story.
Are you still working on the documentary?
Yeah, I finished and I screened last week and I'll be screening on March 18th also. So I just finished.
And how do we find out where that screening is happening?
That screening, if you follow the Visionary Justice Story Lab, I'll throw it in the YouTube chat. They're a Southern Filmmakers grant collective, and they are hosting the screening. And it's virtual, so you can just tune in.
That's excellent. Well, congratulations. Grace, I know, is in the Zoom room too, but I just wanted to say that how much I enjoyed all of the movies in this segment. So great job, Grace. Kate, if you're watching, excellent work. And thank you so much for speaking with us, John, and for doing this again. We have one final segment, and it's a long and beautiful one with lots of personalities and including some special guests. So let's get into it. This is our last segment of the evening. These are our animations. Enjoy.
Good evening. My name is Mark Russo. I'm a professor of animation in the Department of Art and Design in the College of Design. What you're about to see is a collection of 18 animations created by NC State students. These animations were made last semester as part of a collaboration with the Department of Music at UNC Chapel Hill. Through the summer, I got together with Professor Alan Anderson and Evan Feldman to talk about a possible collaboration with our classes. We knew that we would all be remote with our students, and we wanted to see what we could offer to our classes. In the original plan, the composers in Professor Anderson's class would create one-minute compositions. The animators in my class would create stories based on those compositions, and then the compositions would be performed by small ensembles in Professor Feldman's class. Because of the complete lockdown, we had to drop the performances, and in the end, the process worked this way. We started with a prompt, Dreaming Through Walls. The composers created a 1 to 2 minute composition that they performed based on the prompt. At the same time, the animators set out with the prompt to create a 1 minute story. After 3 weeks, the composers sent their pieces to the animators. The animators chose a piece that best fit their story, and then the real collaboration began. The composers worked to craft a soundtrack that fit the story for the animators, with the animators' feedback. The animations changed based on the work of the composers. The composers were amazing. They saw the vision of the animators and brought their great art and craft to helping them make these animations really come to life. The animators were amazing too. These animators, some of whom have never worked in the medium that they chose to work in, worked by themselves in lockdown. We met and tried to solve technical and story problems. We gave each other feedback, and we tried to keep each other motivated. But in the end, they had to struggle alone. I think that the beauty of the music that we were working with is one of the reasons that we all made it through. These one-minute animations are a testament to how amazing the students are here at NC State and at UNC. I would like to congratulate them all, composers and animators, and I would like to thank Professor Anderson for all of his work on this project. I hope that you enjoy them.
My name is Jane Linville, and my film was called The Folly of Man, or something like that. The assignment was to make a one-minute film with the prompt Dreaming Through Walls, and we had to use a composition from one of the composers at UNC that we were working with. The reason I made what I made for the assignment was that I really wanted to make something that was fun and cool to look at, and not depressing, as it was so tempting to make with all the times and stuff going on. This is the first time I ever made a fully animated film, and so it took some getting used to programs and stuff that I wasn't, like, super familiar with. I think definitely had animated some things before, just, like, little, like, tiny things, but this is the first, like, big, like, project. If you can, you should look at all the backgrounds, because there's lots of little, like, Easter eggs and fun stuff.
Why am I blowing up the bathroom? Okay, look, so my life sucks. I'm 24, I look like a fat, weird owl. I've got this useless degree in, oh god, classical anthropology. My mom charges me rent I can barely afford to sleep in the twin bed I've been farting in since middle school. I have dandruff, and I work here. I run the register at a burger joint. I had to beg the old fogies that run this place to hire me. Thought I'd be, I don't know, dusting off pottery shards somewhere by now, but I'm here. So, like, imagine that that's your life. You had this grand, magical plan for everything, but it's like this. You're on the edge of begging your high school sweetheart to take you back. But then, something changes. For me, that's the bathroom. Being able to teleport, it fixed everything. Now that the feds have come to, like, investigate or whatever, I don't know, I'd rather lose it. I can't fight them, and I can't let it fall into the wrong hands, so I'm blowing it up. Of course I'll miss it, but I don't know, I've already been to so many places. I've been to Greece, to Rome. It's amazing seeing stuff that only exists in textbooks. I visited all my friends with tedious STEM degrees they got out of this highway town. I met a girl in Chicago and, well, I love her. I haven't said it yet, but I do. I'll miss seeing her, but we'll make it work. And I've been to other places too. Sometimes the bathroom will just take me somewhere. I don't know. I hope so. I used to feel like the bathroom was my only way out, but that's not true. I don't have to escape to be happy. I can make happiness here. I can do it. I have to.
My name is Anna Lee, and my film is called Whenever You Want. This was a collaboration with the musicians at UNC to fulfill the prompt Dreaming Through Walls. Something that was difficult about making it was that I made it last year when it was difficult to make anything. But I'm pretty happy with how it turned out, especially some of the pencil animation that you'll see. And it was really fun to get to collaborate with a lot of different people. So I hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Oh, we can't have that. We'll have you fixed up right away, sweetheart. There, much better, don't you think?
Hey, baby. I got a song for you, baby.
Hey, hello. Happy birthday.
You know, it's so exciting.
mortality and all that.
The system is corrupt.
You're
man.
Lucky. I mean, yeah, I wish I would die. In the water could source, die. I'm not
really
actually got a my cake.
Holy
it's
gee,
to be
I'm
alive
tired.
And have to live.
You
it just seems like we're all having fun.
Absolutely
it seems
stunning.
Like
stunning.
Some stunning. Cultures actually
believe.
Coca-Cola.
You're
not
there.
Everyone's
in
goats.
You want,
you know who owns Coca-Cola?
Yeah, maybe I should. I don't know.
No one. No.
Actually, you need to get out of here.
Wait, what?
Yeah, you can't stay here, dude.
God's honest truth.
Hi, my name is Anna Hart, and the title of my film is Within Reach. For this assignment, we had to create a 2-minute animated short with the prompt Dreaming Through Walls. Within Reach is about what it's like to chase validation from other people. I'm really happy with the animated style I was able to achieve with this movie. I hope you guys like it too.
Thank you.
Hello, my name's Nathan Royal, and this is my short film, Our Legacy. It's an animated short based on the prompt, Dreaming Through Walls, that we made in my junior year. I chose this manifestation of the prompt because I wanted to show a big picture, one that shows and demonstrates what might come of humanity if we don't break the barriers between us and dream beyond walls soon enough. Something I struggled with in the creation of this animated short was putting the right blend of honesty, pain, and hope into the message and the visual storytelling. I'm personally proud of how this blend came out and manifested within the short, within the visual storytelling of different shots, the composition, and near the end, within the form of a museum. I won't say any more. I think that the piece will hopefully speak for itself, and I hope you all enjoy.
Hi, everyone. My name is Ken Ortiz. You're about to watch my short film, Surface. We were tasked to explore the phrase dreaming through walls, and mine examines the complexities of skin. I made this because during the initial designing process, I had just got a new printer, and I found it that it'd be a really cool motif to use. And I think it's just a reflection of the time that I made it. One challenge I faced was never having worked with 2D and 3D, so it was a pleasant surprise to see the end result. And something I like is that it explores the vertical orientation. I think with our phones, it kind of opens up a new form of video. And yeah, it's really cool to work with. So thanks again for watching, and I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. Hi there, my name is RJ Washington, and the name of my film is The Door. I made this animation for my studio class, and our prompt was Dreaming Through Walls. With everyone stuck inside during quarantine, I wanted to tell a whimsical story about a girl who's also stuck, but uses her imagination to find an escape. This film is a testament to keeping hope alive, because I was also stuck inside while making it, and that was my biggest challenge in terms of production and, you know, finishing it. But I hope you really enjoy the film, and watch out for a very colorful surprise at the very end.
Hello, this is Akina Obata, and the name of my film is The Sky Will Always Remind Us. And this is about hope, resilience, and encouragement. And this narrative came from an actual dream that I had. And in the dream, these whales came and saved me from drowning, and I think it meant that everything will be okay. And so I made an animation from it. Thank you.
My name is Heike Schneider. My movie is called To Dream Alone, and it was produced last semester for my animation studio, in which we had to produce a 60-second animation for the prompt Dreaming Through Walls, which we then worked with a student composer from UNC to score the music. And then I chose the subject that I did because I wanted to tackle the idea of isolation while we're in this pandemic and what it is like to be alone and getting comfortable being alone. A challenge I had was that 2D animation is very hard. Hand drawing things is really hard, even in Photoshop when you've got digital tools. But something I really enjoyed was experimenting with layers and effects in the final editing. So watch for that in the more abstracted parts of my animation. Thanks.
All right, what an extraordinary collection of movies we just saw. We're having a little back channel texting with the programming librarian, Marion Fragola, who is instrumental in making this happen, talking about just how high quality they always are, but this is just a stunning collection. So very excited to have several animators and also some other folks in the Zoom with us today. Including some special guests. So let's start with the NC State folks. RJ, you're here. I'm just gonna go down based on the grid I'm seeing. RJ, can you introduce yourself and remind us what we saw of yours?
Hi guys, I'm RJ Washington and my short film was called The Door. Yeah.
Great, and Kent, you're here. Hi Kent.
Hi, yeah, mine was a Surface.
And you're in the, I think, Kent, you're definitely in the same place where your intro was filmed. So that's great.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Nothing's changed.
Anna, hello.
Hi. My film was, what's it called? Whenever You Want. And Nathan Royal here's here too.
I was Our Legacy.
Gosh, I was so happy to see you just pop into the back of that frame. Too. That's great. We also have a couple of special guests. So Alan is here. Alan, do you want to talk a little bit about your role and Alexander as well?
Yeah, so Jason, thanks for having me. I was at the UNC end of this operation way back about 35 minutes ago. You may remember that Professor Mark Russo gave an introduction and talked about this collaboration between the animators in his class at NC State and the composition students in my class at in Chapel Hill, UNC. He also mentioned that we were originally going to have some live performers involved, but in fact, the whole nature of this project, Dreaming Through Walls, made that dream an impossibility in the end. So the music that you heard was, in most instances, created on the UNC students' laptops. I will make note, though, that one of the scores, one of Daniel Bennett's scores, was actually, he played all the parts live into his computer. It was the the most rock sounding of the soundtracks. He played all those parts. And Jason Reiser, who appeared in multiple films and sometimes the same score appeared in several of the animations. He has a habit of taking and playing on his electric keyboard right into his computer. So some of that stuff is, you know, the sound, the touch of his fingers being played. But my student, Alex McKevney, who's here, his score, by comparison, which you heard in three animations, took advantage of the great processes of the possibilities, I guess, of composing virtually, that he had a part that has a prominent harp track in it, a part that I guess he and I are still wondering if it's actually physically possible for a harpist to play it. Yeah, so it was fun. Many more animators than there were composers, and therefore, as I said, some scores appeared more than once, and several of the composers appear multiple times throughout this.
I think it's such a cool collaboration. I haven't talked about it much, but sound design and sound tracking are some of my favorite parts of these moving image showcases. Because we're are your hosts today, I want Alex to pipe up a little bit from the composer's side, and then we'll talk to our animators from state about this too. But Alex, what were you? This whole thing is intriguing to me, and the cross like triangle collaboration is too. What were you fed in order to know what to do?
Yeah, it was difficult at the beginning of the semester. We were given the same prompt as the animators, dreaming through walls, and I believe we started off with the hope that we would get live performers. Which quickly spiraled because we realized that was not going to be possible in the environment. So it became just kind of whatever instrumentation, whatever you wanted to do, but it was still with the same prompt in mind of dreaming through walls that the animators also had. And so we were both kind of working from there. And we created a score or like music and then brought it to the animators, and they picked what they wanted, I guess. And there was even some further collaboration after that where they would give us feedback and say, you know, this would kind of work better for my film if you could extend this part longer or whatever. And so we collaborated that way as well. And so that the music fit with the film better than if we just created a song and then just shoved it in somewhere. So, yeah, it went back and forth for a while until we finally got the finished product.
I mentioned in the chat that I really liked hearing the same pieces throughout many of the animations because they all worked well, but you get that feeling of image and sound combining can make total different feelings come through depending on how it works. Anna, I'd like to ask you, so I am super interested in the collaboration, but I also kind of want to know, and we were kind of back channeling chat about this too. Your pencil drawings were noted as being pretty amazing in here, and you also had some cool sound layering going on. How much did the collaboration influence what you were going to animate anyway? I know that you had the prompt, but like, did knowing that there was going to be music that you picked from influence the drawing, or did the drawing happen first? How did that work for you?
So I kind of didn't write the film because I didn't want to. So I was like, I contacted a bunch of people and was like, send me sound clips.
Right.
And I wrote the beginning and the end, but then fit the rest of it around what people sent me. And Alex's score was very wonderful. So thank you for that.
So is everyone who is in, several of the people who actually contributed to that layering are in this Zoom room right now, isn't that true? One, yep. And RJ, you were part of that as well?
Yep,
I was. I think I was tired flower or something.
RJ, how did that How did the collaboration work for you? And also, like, I guess similar question to Anna, like, what were these things already percolating, prompt or not, that this was the kind of project you wanted to do?
Would you like me to go first or Anna?
Let's start with you, RJ, and then we'll kind of circle around.
Okay. I was very excited to work on this project. It was the first animation I've ever like actually made, like start to finish. So I generally start with music whenever I am making something creative like this, because that's kind of like what helps give me like the different ideas. So like I had general concepts floating in my head, but I was really waiting on the music in order to like actually get something down. So I remember I was looking through all of the tracks that were sent to us, and I was like, okay, this song is nice, this is really good. But Liz Yardley, I heard her track and I was immediately like, this is it, this is the one for me. And it just blows my mind how talented she is. I remember I was already really happy with the track, but she sent me another version she was working on. I was like, I love this even better. Can we hop on a Zoom call and talk about this? And she literally did something during our 20 minute Zoom call, like input in a few notes. It sounded so much better and it still blows my mind. Like, I really don't understand how it was even possible. So that aspect of collaboration was so amazing, having original music made for these animations. It just really made everything even more special. And I was able to work with just really great people. So that was another fantastic element to it.
That's great. I often make the comparison of like, when you choose to do something like, I don't know, go vegan, for whatever reason, you learn more about food when you limit what food you eat. And in an era of a pandemic, when we have all these limitations, we get to do these amazing experiments where we're collaborating across schools to have original music and animation working at the same time, which maybe we would have done anyway, but then it turns out to be just as magical in a totally different way. Like fixing that during a Zoom call sounds pretty spectacular. So Nathan, you wanted your piece to speak for itself after seeing it, you know, on the small screen, and kind of like alongside all these others. Do you feel like you accomplished that goal?
I think so. A lot of what I kind of invested in was visual storytelling, because I knew the character just wouldn't have any voice, and his eye changing shape was supposed to show what he was feeling and thinking. So just things like that. I, in a way, kind of sacrificing that, you know, the voices or you know, more humanoid characters, it kind of made it, I don't know, I think it made it focus more on the visuals. And because of that, I think it sells its point better, because I had more time and energy to focus on that.
I thought it was really successful. And again, with the shared soundtracks showing those different textures that could be possible, it was beautiful. Kent, your experiment with vertical video in an otherwise horizontal format was super fascinating. Also really hard to project. Like I didn't want to do that classic like terrible local news thing where it's like, you know, mirrored on the sides. And I actually opened it up on my phone during the stream and realized that YouTube would only take what I gave it. But it looked beautiful and the animation style itself was wonderful. Were you actually composing on the phone? I couldn't tell if that was how it was working. Were you doing?
No, that would have been insane though, but
it would have been, yeah. It's a...
like it was a matter of just like changing the dimensions to fit the size of a phone. And there was like another project I had done in one of Mark Russo's class where I had experimented with the vertical orientation. And I just thought it was really fun because I would go like on, you know, Instagram, Snapchat, and like these people that are experimenting with that format, I was like, oh, I think it's a lot more intimate instead of it being vertical. So yeah, it was just something fun to experiment.
And do you actually have a printer that is that big?
Yeah, let me bring you guys over.
This is great.
I have like used it like three times. It's like very big. It's like an office printer.
Oh, wow. Congratulations.
Yeah. It's very handy.
And, you know, that's, you know, spatially, when you have things like that move into your room, you're definitely going to make a movie about it.
Yeah, it like happened out of nowhere. It was just because I needed it for one of my classes. And I was just like, okay, but it's actually really cool. And the way it works and the idea that it can just run and make duplicates. It was just really fascinating.
Well, it came through really, I'm happy that it exists for real, because
yeah.
It came through really well in the movie. So we've gone over, but I'm just so pleased with everyone hanging out and making such beautiful work. Because NC State's hosting, we did have a question in the chat from my colleague Marion, and I'd like Alex and Alan maybe to speak to this. And Marion asked, I'd love to know how the musicians felt about having their work animated. We just heard RJ just very eloquently talk about how beautiful it is to have individual pieces of music made for something that you did, but like, how does it feel in reverse, Alex? Like, you touched on it a little bit, but now you've seen it over and over again. How's it feel?
Yeah, it's interesting. When I'm like composing or like writing music, I don't think about anything other than the music. Like, there's no extra musical idea that comes into my head. Like, I'm thinking about the music, but there's not like a plot line or anything. There's not like, oh, this is an action and this is a response. To, like, very in very basic terms, I guess. But there's not like some sort of cinematic plot line to the music that I'm writing. So seeing different people's interpretation of the music, because my piece was used in multiple animations, seeing that was interesting to me, because I don't think about it when I'm writing the music, but I guess other people hear the music and that's the impression that it gives. So it's interesting to me to see like what do people think about, or what is their impression of my music while they're listening to it. So that was very interesting to me.
That's great. Well, thank you so much for being a part of it. And Alan, as an instructor, what are your thoughts about the success of this project?
Oh, I thought it was very successful. It's interesting to me as the teacher of a class to have yet another reason for the students to finish things. They're waiting for it. You know, all I hear from NC State is the animators really want to see hear some music to work with. So it is really fun. And I would sort of, in response to the previous question, just that you asked Alex, I'll just point out that of the composers whose music you heard, there were five different composers. Only one of them had ever worked in any context that related to film and not in animation. And is for all most of them, you know, it was a completely new experience to work this way. And it's also stimulating in the sense that they get that kind of most important maybe feedback is timing. One of the things I talked about with the composers as we saw storyboards beginning to assemble is, well, how fast do you think this is moving, and is the tempo of your music appropriate for that? And from the other direction, watching the films now in their completed form, having heard the music as it was being made, I see, oh, the animator asked for some more time right here. I can perceive that happening. So as Alex was saying, from his perspective, he has only written music that was thought of as like for the concert stage, you know, the musicians come out and play. But in this context, there are other things that one needs to consider. All this is great for the education of composers, students or otherwise.
That's excellent. Well, thanks again to all of the animators and to everyone who participated this year, this semester. Again, for us at the libraries, this is always one of the like most, we think about this program a lot. There's a lot of moving parts. So I'd like to thank everybody who decided to make parts to go along, to add to the machine that is the beauty of this showcase. You know, for those of you who are graduating, we hope you'd stop by and see what happens next semester. For those of you who are still going to be around, we hope that you are taking more production classes here at State, whether it's animation or film or video, and even if we're still behind some sort of wall in the upcoming time, you know, like, let's keep communicating this way, because it's such a great way to reach people, to really feel what they're feeling, and to just enjoy a little bit of beauty while we don't get to see as much as we were. So thanks so much to everybody. And we hope to see you again soon. And keep an eye out for the replays of this, especially Emily, who has to have hers replayed in appropriate aspect ratios. So thanks, everybody. Take care and have a great night.
Thank you.
Good job, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.